As the eldest, I'd always looked after my brother and sister. Tostin was 2 years safely gone from Hurog, but since Ciara was both adventurous and mute, her safety was a constant undertaking. Ciara was supposed to be helping Mother today, but I knew Mother, and I knew Ciara, too. With my uncle and cousins here, I should have stayed home, but the mountains had called to me. We were bound to be late for dinner now, unless Father's hunting party took longer than usual. But at least with both of us equal miscreants, my father would concentrate on me instead of Ciara. The tunnel narrowed and branched, making me rue the 3 fingers height I'd gained already this summer as I scrunched into the cleaner and smaller of the 2 tunnels. I could see dwarven stones shining down it where someone had activated them, while the other one, the bigger one, was dark ahead. Trust the brat to choose the smallest way. I scuttled ahead, fighting the feeling that the walls were collapsing. After I was well in, the tunnel tilted dramatically upward for a few body lengths before starting downward nearly as steeply. I hit my head on a low spot and stopped to think a minute. I might not be a dwarf, but I knew the sewers worked because water flowed downhill. This tunnel had been designed to keep water out of it, rather than let the water flow to the river. I closed my eyes and tried to envision what the map had indicated, but I'd found it months ago, and beyond noting a few interesting features, I hadn't given it much attention. How was I supposed to guess my sister would choose to run around the sewer tunnels? I rubbed my head and decided that this must be an escape tunnel. All the old castles had them, a legacy from a day when Hurog, rich with dwarven trade, had been worth besieging. I was still considering it when Ciara went from being not too distant from me to being somewhere far below. I stopped breathing. She must have fallen. I thought as I frantically scrambled forward, perhaps through a trap door intended to keep besiegers from following some long-ago ancestor as he fled his attackers through this tunnel. Gods, oh gods, my little sister! I scrambled forward like a frog, pushing with my legs and reaching out with my hands in the awkward fashion I'd had to adopt in the small tunnel, all the while thinking, it's too far down, she's fallen too far. One moment I was scuttling along, and the next I couldn't so much as blink my eyes. My face went numb, and magic flooded around me. Underneath my hand, the smooth stone of the tunnel began to glow red and green, brighter by far than the faint light of dwarven stone. It was so bright that after a moment I had to close my watering eyes against the intensity. That's why I had no warning when the floor of the tunnel disappeared out from under me, and I fell. The magic left me lying flat on my stomach in utter blackness. I pushed up, but the ceiling had closed above me, leaving me barely enough room to lift my head off the ground. My hands were trapped underneath me, and though I pulled and wiggled, I couldn't get them out. I panicked and fought ferociously against the stone walls cocooning me. I cried out like one of the silly maids, but there was no one to hear. The thought stopped my useless struggling. If anyone had heard me, my father would have seen to it that I spent a lot more time trapped in darkness. Men don't panic, don't cry, don't grieve. But I did. I blinked back my tears, but my nose dripped. I'd lost contact with Ciara when the spell hit me. I looked for her again, hoping she'd been caught in the same spell that had held me. But she was still deeper. She wasn't moving. I had to get to her. The tunnel was far smaller than the one I'd been crawling through. In my thrashing, well, I'd tried to thrash anyway, panic, I'd established that the ceiling was as solid as it felt, no matter that I had just fallen through it. There was something blocking the way behind me, but cool, fresh air blew by my flushed face, so I could probably go forward if I could get my hands out from under my body where they were trapped. Having already proven I couldn't pull them both out at the same time, I started with my left hand, which was trapped farther forward than my right. The terror at being caught with my hands pinned against my side brought on 1 or 2 bouts of panic, but when I was finished and lay sweating and shaking in the darkness, I still had nothing to do but continue wriggling my hand up. The tightest part was pulling my elbow past my chest and shoulders, and I struggled for a long time before admitting defeat. I lay sweating and relaxed a moment, Hopelessly, I leaned my weight to the right and pushed my arm forward. It slid out. I stretched it above my head and wiggled it. As relief let me think clearly once more, I realized what must have happened. Relaxed, my shoulders took up less room than they did tightened with the force of my struggles. The right hand was easier than the left, but by the time I'd finished, the cold from the stone had sunk to my bones, and I was shivering with it. With both hands in front pulling and shifting the rest of my body as well as I could, I was able to start forward. My forearms hurt from being dragged across the rough stone each time I pulled, and my shoulders were scraped raw because they were wider than the tunnel. Likely by the time I finished, they'd be a few inches narrower. I pushed with my feet, too, or at least with my toes. Unused to such strange exercise, they cramped after a while. I stretched them as best I could, though it was maddening not to be able to bend down and rub them with my hands. It seemed as though I'd crawled forever before the absolute darkness in front of me let up. Somewhere ahead, there was light. Perversely, it was almost harder to go on, as if the knowledge that things were looking up made it more difficult to continue the effort. After a bit, it grew still lighter. Of course, with my luck, the light might be coming from a dwarven stone embedded in a wall that sealed the tunnel. But pessimism lost. My tunnel curved, and I saw that the light came from a hole in the floor. I slid my head over the edge and looked out to see, a long way below me, the floor of a large natural cave. My view was obscured by the twisted stalactites that surrounded my opening. I couldn't tell if Ciara's body was lying below, though magic whispered that she was probably in that cave. On the right-hand edge of my hole were two metal spikes driven into the rock. Tied to each spike was a rope. One of the ropes was about a foot long and frayed at the end. The other dangled through the thicket of stalactites until I lost sight of it. The rope looked very old, and I wasn't a lightweight. But Ciara waited for me below, and so I reached for it and held on to it as I pulled the rest of my body out of the cave. The relief of being free of the stone embrace was almost enough to distract me from Ciara for a moment. The rope wasn't the ladder, though it might have been part of one once, but it was better than nothing. After I cleared the stone formations on the ceiling of the cave, I could tell that the rope only reached 2/3 of the way to the floor. I worried about what I was going to do for the last 10 feet, but I needn't have. The rope broke before I got quite that far. As I hit the ground, I rolled as my father's arms master drilled into me until it was second nature. Even so, I hit hard. After tumbling over once or twice, I stopped against a broken outcropping. I lay there for a moment, trying too hard to catch my breath to worry about where I was. At last, my air came back in a rush, and I stumbled to my feet. I'd rolled up against the remains of a broken column that looked to have spanned from floor to ceiling in ages past. The cavern was huge, at least twice as big as the great hall in the keep. The mouth of the tunnel I'd fallen from was along the edge of the room and relatively low. In the center of the room, the ceiling was much higher, perhaps as tall as Hurug's walls, though it was hard to judge. Dwarven stones were everywhere, brighter than the ones in the sewer, making the room actually lighter than the castle was even during the day. There was no body crumpled on the floor. Ciara wasn't anywhere to be seen, but she was nearby. "Hello?" I called out. "Brat?" A small form hurtled at me and thunked her head into my ribs. I grabbed Ciara around the waist and swung her around twice before setting her firmly on her feet and shaking her. "You scared me to death, brat. What idiot notion took you that you ran into the sewers?" Ciara's long blonde hair, lighter even than mine, hung in a muddy tangle halfway down her back. She wore tunic and trousers similar to mine, and her feet were bare. She looked pitiful, but I wasn't fooled. Pitiful wasn't repentant. "Come on, brat," I said with resignation. "Let's find our way out of here." Though my initial relief at finding her was overwhelming, if I couldn't find a way out,